somebody said, whoever around here somewhere said we're involved in this thing to break into the hotel computer, which we weren't.
To this day, I think it's kind of entertaining, if not pathetic, to read our indictment, to see how they formulated that MOD was some evil society whose plot was to control the computers of the world.
Make a good hack means make something very good, on a good way, with a good mind.
It's definitely the key to something. We have two possible theories. One, that it's where the aliens are housed. And two, that it's to their library.
This door here leads to the public area, being the platform. The most important thing is to pretend we belong there.
At the time, I didn't even know they were making nukes. If I knew they made nukes, I would have stayed the hell away from Westinghouse.
Well, there are databases all over the place that have cursory information about Americans. As long as you're a consumer, you're somewhere in them.
We had a network connected to the internet of about 200 computers on a camping site, imagine. Must have been the largest outdoor network for non-military purposes.
This there's a project going on in Yugoslavia, in former Yugoslavia. We're trying to put up a network, a transnational network, between several groups in Zagreb, in Sarajevo, and in Belgrade. And I think when people can talk to each other and are not censored through state media, well, there will be peace, maybe.
Basically, I was awoken by two strangers in my bedroom who were pretty much waving guns in my face and telling me to freeze and not to move.
And today is a rather monumental occasion. It's the last program that Fibroptic will be on before he's sent to prison. For a period of a year and a day. Good evening, Aaron.
Being a formal federal officer, I can honestly say that Fiber is the only guy that I've ever felt sorry for going to prison.
I think that in the years to come, this will be recognized as a time of a witch hunt approximately equivalent to McCarthyism, that some of our best and brightest were made to suffer this kind of persecution for the fact that they dared to be creative in a way that society didn't understand.
It's got them doing more than just getting scared and saying, I better follow the law. I think a lot of them are saying, we better change the law.
So anyway, that's about all, Fiber. You know, just try to read a lot, you know, and work out a lot. And get the number for that computer so we can hack into it. And, you know, maybe reduce the amount of days.
My specific instance, I was charged with conspiracy to commit a few dozen overt acts, they called them, which ranged among a number of things having to do with computer trespass and I guess computer eavesdropping, interception. And the second charge was unauthorized access to federal interest computers, which is a pretty vague law. And I would suppose in my instance that the federal interest computers in question would be phone company computers, or communications network computers, and so on, would be considered in the federal interest.
He learned the wrong things. He got into systems, he learned how they worked, he told other people how they worked, and the people that ran the systems didn't want that to happen.
I'm frequently on a radio show with Emmanuel Goldstein of 2600 Magazine, on a local radio station, WBAI, and we talk about how corporations and big business and the phone company often take advantage of the average consumer.
UCI, together with its partners, will invest more than $20 billion over the next 6 years to create a veritable brain trust of the information age, the space-time continuum.
Yes, the space-time continuum is being challenged. The notion of communication has changed forever. All the information in the universe will soon be accessible to everyone at every moment.
Are they really saying this?
This is all here in today's New York Times with an MCI. It's the most incredible ad I've ever seen.
When I was 13 or 14 years old, and things were a lot different, people more or less just did this stuff because it was interesting, it was challenging, and it was a great way to learn about technology that you wouldn't normally have access to, being a 14-year-old kid or even a 21-year-old kid. So I can't say I've ever thought that I'd ever end up in prison.
So, Fiber, this is it.
Yeah, this is it.
All right. Take care, and we'll see you in 10 months or so.
Yep. I'll see everyone around.
Frankly, I'm pissed off about everything. I mean, considering the way I was sentenced, the judge's exact words were that he was sentencing me as a symbol to send a message. Well, what kind of justice is that? Let them send a message some other way.
Agent Steele is a guy who's been around since the early 80s. A lot of people have known him. Very secretive. You could only contact him through numbers that died every month, and he would hand out new numbers to people he trusted. Lived in Los Angeles. Wrote a lot of interesting files, definitely into electronic fund transfers, the banking system, pulling scams, social engineering. Money was his big thing. Any way he could get money, he was interested in it.
Agent Steele tried to get me to break into central offices, remote switching units, TimeNet, Telenet nodes, tried to get me to DataTap. He just did all kinds of stuff.
Apparently was caught along with Polson. And cooperated in turning him in. What I've heard is that he turned state's evidence on a few other people, and in return, he's been given immunity and protection.
That's Agent Steele. He's on the run. He was involved in credit card fraud, even though he was an FBI informant at the time. He narked off Polson, Ron Austin, me, Mitnick, Roscoe, who knows how many other people who we haven't even heard about, just to say, hey, he can stay out of trouble and keep hacking.
My husband and I drive up to the house after being away all day. Noah and his sister are out of town. There's this strange car parked on the corner, which I notice as we drive up. And the other thing I notice as we drive into the garage is that out of this strange car get two men who start walking right up our driveway to the house. And I immediately had the feeling that they were some kind of law enforcement. But they weren't regular cops. They did not wear uniforms. One guy was wearing a suit, one guy was wearing a leather jacket, and they just had that other kind of cop look. And they came right up to us, and I think they asked for us by name. I think they asked, you know, our last name. And I immediately knew that this had something to do with Noah and something to do with the computer.
I come back from spring break, come to my house, my parents tell me, guess who came to the door yesterday, Noah? I was like, oh, who? And my parents tell me that the Secret Service came to our door, and of course I thought they were kidding, because they knew about how I was using computers, and I kind of suspected that they thought I was a hacker.
The thought of him being taken away to some federal prison just really, really upset me. And I think I would have done, if I really believed that was going to happen, I would have done almost anything to avoid that. Not because I condone anyone breaking the law, but it just seemed like in that case the law had a really heavy hand.
I mean, I equate it to petty vandalism. I equate it to the other kind of thoughtless things that younger people do.
What saved me was the fact that I was not malicious. I didn't go for the data. I just went for the access to the networks. My age, definitely. I was only 13 at the time when I was in Westinghouse, and 14 when the Secret Service agents busted me. Like I said before, they're not going to throw a 14-year-old in federal prison.
Just like I become sort of paralyzed in the conflict of, well, is this really, you know, how bad is this really? How bad was that really? I mean, what was the damage? I mean, what was, you know, this is all gray area stuff.
And Westinghouse was completely unpasswarded. Some of the lamest security I have ever seen. And it was just a big embarrassment for them considering they dealt with nukes.
Information America offers a service, and they're very covert about it. They don't really advertise except to law enforcement, lawyers, bounty hunters. They offer a service where for $80 a minute kind of thing, it's very expensive. You can log on, you can do skip traces on people, find out, based on a last known address, where they are, find out, do they have liens on their properties? Are they the agents of foreign corporations? Do they own any corporations? Do they have shares? Who are they employed with? Who do they live with? All kinds of information like that.
We have a remote system by the name of Boomtown that we're going to break into. Boomtown is a file server, which means that it services about a dozen or more people, and it holds all their mail, their personal files, their work on the system. So if we break into this one system, we're going to get into, in essence, a dozen different people's machines. The easiest thing to do in order to break into this machine is to access a user's home directory. We enable our remote machine to be able to access the machine, and then we log into the remote machine. From this point on, we are in control of everything they do. If they want to, we can delete files, we can modify files, we can examine all these files. Of course, that would be entirely unethical, as everyone knows. But that's pretty much about it. We are, in essence, in control of everything they are. We control everything on the computer. It takes all of about 10 seconds to break into someone's computer if you know what you're doing.
Breaking is a more hardware-oriented thing, and it deals solely with the phone system. Learning how the phone switching works, how to manipulate them, just the ins and outs of everything.
This is a red box. It basically simulates quarter tones being inserted into the payphone.
5 cents. And put the coin in. In this particular place, which is Malaysia, I have to send 2600 first to get it cleared off. Okay, at this you should start hearing the call connecting. There you hear a ringing in the States.
Will we hang up?
Please leave any messages after the tone.
I made a call to the United States, and of course, my 25 cents comes back.
Basically is going through the trash of a company, car dealer, phone company, just any system that you think you might want to get information from.
Hello?
there's some group that is relatively obscure who seems to have been genuinely interested in finding out any UFO stuff that might be available on government computers. There actually is classified and secret information on computers that are available on the net, although they're not supposed to. And this, according to the story, these guys were able to get into machines, military machines, connected to the net, or just off the net, searching for keywords, anything having to do with UFOs or aliens, and they found something. And they compiled this file on all the sites that had promising information, the information that they found, what they knew, everything. Some of the people who found this information are no longer around. Ostensibly, they were busted for one thing or another and have not been heard from since. They just disappeared.
You know, everything in the lock was carried by hand up these stairs. So just remember that when you see the vats, the two vats. Here we go. You know, some people have asked, like, what exactly, you know, what is the loft? And I was just like, well, it's like a clubhouse. Except we don't have secret handshakes or anything. But it's neat too when we have like friends over, like visiting from out of state or whatever. And they're into computers like we are. You know, there's a place we can bring them here, and they can sleep here. I mean, initially we were just looking for storage space, you know, to just store stuff, and it's turned into sort of a weird communal thing.
I've had a lot of this stuff for years. It's been in my basement, just sitting there, and I've never been able to use it. And now I've been able to bring it over here to the loft and actually use the stuff and play with it and see what it can actually do.
Talk to somebody, you know, over the net, say, oh, I got a question about, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, all right, let me dig out my manual and look it up. Well, I mean, here you can go and read somebody else's manual or ask them face-to-face. And it's a lot easier to share information when you're talking face-to-face.
All these manuals.
I know. Yeah, no shit.
The actual hardware, you can't get that online. And
yeah.
So you can...
Like, I want to learn how to hack Netware 311. Well, come here. You can hack our own LAN, you know. I don't care.
This is just... It's this project that me and Brian Oblivion are working on. It's basically just a telephone dialer run off a microprocessor. It's like the demon dialer from Hacktic. It does all the tones, blue box, red box, green box.
It's just the access to the technology is like centralized here, you know, in a place where anybody can come, you know, who's really into it. And learn. I mean, that's the most important thing. We want to learn about everything. So,
it's come to me more than just a magazine. It's an attitude. It's a way people think of things. People ask questions. People spread information. People gather together. People basically challenge authority in various ways. And that's what 2600 has become. You know, it started out with a magazine, but it's growing in many different ways. You know, we have meetings all over the world now where people get together and explore things and trade information.
Not anymore. Now I'm getting it through internet, your next pet step.
Yeah.
From, I got the site, you know, like a video vindicator? Like, I have the site. Did you see the new 2600?
No.
It has something about cell phones.
Yeah, but the old one had something about programming.
So, wait. Right now, there's 32K of data that you can read and write to that's in the phone.
You can read and write to almost all of it.
Except for the code.
Some of it's software. The NAM shit is software protected.
Yeah.
The ESN's hardware protected.
So we have to cut a trace.
Maybe.
Dude, why couldn't they just, like, make it real simple so you could, like, plug the shit in, write your code?
Other people do. You know why they don't? Because it's cheaper that way, man. It's cheaper.
Well, you should stop by. Probably, don't they have one down in San Diego?
Ooh, isn't this fun? Let's scan and see what kind of signal strengths we get.
Okay.
Right now we're scanning the cellular channels. It's illegal and if we listen to the conversation. Haha, but we're not.
How about if you come pick me up and we go over to the event ourselves together?
somebody said, whoever around here somewhere said we're involved in this thing to break into the hotel computer, which we weren't. Just because the phones, they're going, like, the phone lines are running outside our room. They're saying that, oh, just because it's running outside our room, it's somehow, like, telepathically or something, we're trying to break into the computer.
First of all, I have a public service announcement here. As a result of things that happened last night, I think that it's very important for people to practice this. I want everyone to repeat after me. Okay. I want to talk to my lawyer.
And if anybody's wondering, that's why all the police were here last night, because they were busting the lawyer's board.
Hacker crackdown. Law and Disorder on the Electronic Frontier, now available in a mildly expensive paperback with the useful index. For 1/1/94, the official release date, it goes online on the internet globally, okay? With a new introduction and a new afterword, free. Free.
A reason I put on HoloCon is I feel it's fairly important to bring everybody from all walks of, you know, the computer industry and telecommunications together, both the quote-unquote hackers and freakers and people from the telco and computer security business, so they can meet and meet each other face-to-face and get good discussions going and talk to each other and establish debates and panels and kind of get to know one another.
Why does the hacker community have to go to the security community, the guys in the suits and everything, and force them to sit down and listen and have to risk getting busted, risk being exposed, or whatever? There's two answers to that. First of all, the guys who make a living doing security and are trying to protect themselves are scared shitless of you, because you can just ruin them. And the fact that you haven't until now, they're just trying to go, well, what do they want? Why aren't they ruining us? They can. Why aren't they? They can do it. You can do it. So they're scared of you, first of all. Second of all, they can't find you. You hide very well. That's what you do. That's why most of you don't use your real names. That's why nobody filled in the paperwork out in the front that says, please give us your phone number. Who's stupid enough to give their phone number to HackerCon? I don't know.
You know, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, and we know exactly what phone line someone's calling in on, and they're going from there to doing an RM minus RF in Colorado Springs. And I call Southwestern Bell, and I say, you know, we've got a hacker, and we would like you to do a tap trace. Well, we're sorry, we can't do that without a court order. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I can't get a court order. And say, like, well, we're sorry, sir. Unless you get a court order, we're not going to do the tap trace. So we're thinking of changing our login message to you. Hackers are respectfully requested to call only between the hours of 9 and 5, Monday through Friday.
It just kind of denotes that, you know, all the rumors are true. And on the back this year, we have the HoloCon 93. Top 10 narc list.
What we've done with this project is get together a lot of messages from a lot of classic bulletin boards, underground bulletin boards from the 80s mostly, and we've got a lot of really good ones in there. We've got Farmers of Doom, which is a 1985 board ran by Mark Tavis here, and some really excellent stuff on there. We've got together a lot of files from the underground of the past, and I think that the project is really positive because, well, for a lot of reasons. One, the historical perspective, you know. You can look back and see what was going on at the time. And two, a lot of the things in there, you know, there's theoretical background that can still apply to the day's underground, you know. And three, I think that, like, the social scene was different then. You know, this is before Wired and Mondo and everything. You know, this was like TAP and 2600 were around.
This year I had more than just a few security personnel tell me that they were really happy that they came because they got a chance to meet the people that they considered to be like little rampant chaotic anarchists who had nothing better to do than go blow stuff up and break into every system out there and just cause chaos and destruction. And when they meet them face to face and they find out that they're quite intelligent and well-spoken and polite and they can talk to them one-on-one and really get to know them, I think that their opinions kind of change.
I think that most hackers are at least interested in locks and other forms of physical security because they resemble security in the digital domain so much. There's so many parallels between the way a computer is secured, a computer network is secured, and the way buildings are secured.
Now, the story here leads to the public area being the platform. The most important thing is to pretend we belong there.
We're supposed to walk out of here.
We're supposed to walk out of that door. So do not look around, do not look, did anybody see me?
Step in, quickly.
Carbon filters. They filter the air. This little fellow here pumps the air around. And then because the suckers that built all this were scared,
they built it again.
They built it all twice. These beds for hundreds and hundreds of people down here.
Paul. I'm going to take the stairs. Like...
Recently, Hactic started a computer network, internet provider. We provide access to the internet, public access Unix. And it's becoming more than that because Holland doesn't have any internet providers that cater to just ordinary people or ordinary hackers, or if there is such a thing. So it started out as a UUCP network, a network for mail and news forwarding. And it's now turned into an online internet network that's one of the biggest in Western Europe as far as providing internet to normal people.
Initially, a year ago, they saw us as a criminal organization. We had a lot of very unfavorable press. And this has been changing throughout the last 12 months, well, because of the projects we are doing. So first we started the public Unix. Well, they were still saying those techno-anarchists, oh, they're so dangerous. And then we had our Congress in August, which also received very favorable press. And we had one more article in like November, which was talking about techno-anarchists and the danger of techno-anarchism. And then since the digital city started, they have disappeared.
Hackers are viewed as very dangerous, subversive people. The fact that you hang out with a group of people that calls themselves techno-anarchists is really viewed as very, very dangerous and very, very subversive.
After our last Congress, people came to us with ideas about a digital city. So we joined in, talked a lot about it, have been preparing about a half a year. And the system turned out to be a great success. It's like a system everybody can use. So the intention is to have people meet the internet. What is the internet? Well, by with the digital city, they can get to know the internet. This is the library, and the library has connections to other libraries in Amsterdam and throughout the world. Then we have our building for the arts, which is like a digital museum. And we have several artists putting their art in this museum.
Well, Hacking at the End of the Universe was a three-day hacker congress. There was this camping site, and about 700 to 1,000 hackers had gathered and were camping there for 3 days with their tents. And we had a really huge tent for podium discussions. We had discussions about phone phreaking, hacking and law. Since March 1993, we also have laws against hacking and phreaking in Holland. We had a big podium discussion about networking, alternative forms of networking. And we had a lot of smaller workshops. It is important because it's a congress where everybody's very open. We had a lot of publicity. Everybody was welcome. We tried to invite people who are against hacking to explain their point of view. We wanted to have an open discussion. We wanted to show that we are not some hackers sitting in a dark corner doing illegal things.
I think hackers will have a role here in defending the network like it is today. The internet is very anarchistically built, and to my favor, it should stay like this. There should not be a tremendous amount of companies playing net police or playing developers or things like that. The way it has been up till now, by being a scientific network built by scientists, has proven to be a very efficient and also a very pleasant way of expanding this network. But this will change in a negative way.
German hackers always had some feeling of responsibility. I wouldn't say American or Dutch hackers are not responsible, but there's a lot of there's more fun in the Dutch approach to hacking.
So this is our robot camera, another way to create an interaction, but to let the television viewer look behind the scene, so he can watch us in our TV studio, how we are doing, how the technique is looking, what people we are, and he can talk with us. Social hacking. It's using new technology in a way which is not intended to use it like this. Telephone was never be intended to be to put the individuum onto a mass media.
Phobot is the organization in Bielefeld. It means a club for the advancement of data traffic. It is where people meet, where things happen. It can be anything. You can describe it as a culture club, computer culture club. It is more than just a hacking club to me. I got involved during the Gulf War when I found papers of the Philwood BBS Bionic in a tent where activists met, and I found this was interesting to communicate over the network with people to think about solutions for a better world, and so I got involved and I bought my first modem 1 week after that.
One member of Philwood goes to Yugoslavia when the war starts there, and the idea was to get the peace groups connected together by email, and there was a problem that he can settle up, of course, BBS or MAS, but they not always they can come through together. And so we make here from Bielefeld a phone call to every BBS in Yugoslavia, and they route their information via Bielefeld. And just in this moment now he is starting to a plane to Sarajevo, settle up a bulletin board there too. And this is quite difficult because there's no power electricity in the town and no phone lines. And it's quite funny, we use a diesel generator for the BBS and video conference line for the data transfer.
In former Yugoslavia, we have a very tense situation between the parties at war, and the telephone lines between Serbia and Croatia are cut, so the citizens of one part can't communicate with those people in the other part, and people can't imagine that people in these places like Bosnia need bulletin boards, but some people think it's the last thing they would need, but in fact they need them very badly, and they've got them now to organize the relief work and organize things for refugees, and also to get the peace groups in the different parts of the country into touch.
Many good ideas are born here. You have people from very different sides of the society. Some do work in Yugoslavia, in peace movement there, and some are pure technical hackers. And I think this can be synthesized to something new, something very special.
There's a man who leads a life of danger. To everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. Chance he takes, odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man, they're giving you a number and taking away your name. Beware of pretty faces that you find. Pretty face can hide an evil mind.